We can also do catalytic hydrogenation of a carbonyl, just like we could with an alkene, to form an alcohol. I'll draw the new hydrogens in red, so you can see what happened. In effect, it was really the same change that would happen if we used lithium aluminum hydride followed by water, or sodium borohydride followed by water. And this reaction works also on an aldehyde or on a ketone to make our alcohol. Now, the one piece about catalytic hydrogenation that's important to remember is that carbon-carbon double bonds are reduced faster than carbon-oxygen double bonds by catalytic hydrogenation. Also, carbon-carbon double bonds are not going to be reduced at all by hydride followed by water. However, CO bonds are reduced. Let's think about that just for a second, why that might be. If I have my lithium aluminum hydride or sodium borohydride, really just an H minus donor, hydride donor, right? And we have an alkene. So remember back to the alkenes chapter, chapter 8, what did alkenes react with? They reacted with some kind of an electrophile. So when we look at that, we said, who has electrons and who wants them? So if I look at that reaction, the alkene has electrons, the electrophile wants electrons. And those are all the reactions. For example, it would react with acid. You could react it with HCl. It would add the H plus first, and then the chloride can add later. Well, now if we look at this reaction on top and say, okay, so if I have an alkene plus a hydride, my alkene has electrons, or is a nucleophile, my hydride has electrons, and there's no one that wants them. So this won't react. Both groups in here are groups that have extra electron density, and so there won't be any reaction. Now, one of my class mantras, of course, is what do organic chemists want to do? And the answer to that always is organic chemists want to control everything. So let's see what we could do with one starting material and three different reactions. What if I want to reduce the entire molecule as much as I can? I reduce my carbonyl to an alcohol, and I reduce my alkene to an alkane. How could I do that? I'll give you a few of these to work on, and then we'll come back and talk about it. What if I want to reduce my alkene, but leave my carbonyl in place? And finally, what if I want to leave my alkene, but reduce only my carbonyl? Okay, so here are three different types of products. I can reduce both of them. I can reduce just the alkene. I can reduce just the carbonyl. You try to write out the reactions while you pause this, and then come back and we'll talk about it. Well, this all relies on the previous statement I was just making about the difference between catalytic hydrogenation and hydride reduction. So if I do catalytic hydrogenation, that really can reduce the carbonyl and the alkene. It will reduce the alkene first. But if I have H2 in excess, so I have lots of H2 in palladium on carbon, I keep it going for a long period of time, I can eventually reduce the whole thing. However, if I only want to reduce the alkene, if I have a small amount of H2 in palladium on carbon, or do it for a shorter time, it will reduce the alkene first. And then finally, we have our new reaction, which is one lithium aluminum hydride followed by water. Then I can reduce only my carbonyl and leave my alkene alone. It's important that these are in separate steps, because if you have H minus, which is a strong base, in water, what would happen? Well, if H minus reacts with water, I'd get OH minus plus H2. And if you want to decide whether that happens or not, of course, you always have to look at pKa's. So pKa of H2 is about 35. Where the pKa of water is 15.74. So which of those two is a stronger acid? Water is a stronger acid by about 10 to the 20. So that means that water is more likely to give up its proton, and this equilibrium lies this way 10 to the 20 times. So we cannot have water around anytime we're using hydrides, lithium aluminum hydride. In fact, lithium aluminum hydride has to be stored carefully so that it doesn't react with water vapor in the air. So what will be the stereochemical result of a carbonyl reduction? So if I start with a ketone that's not symmetrical, and remember I have sp2 hybridized carbon here, my product will be an alcohol. There are four different groups bonded to that carbon. I've got a hydroxide, a hydrogen, a methyl group, and an ethyl. So really, I could draw that as a pair of enantiomers. So my enantiomers, I have S2-butanol, and I have R2-butanol. Since they're two enantiomers, I start with no stereochemistry, I have no chiral reagents, so what should be the percentage of each of these in the product? Of course, it should be a 50-50 mixture, or a racemic mixture of products. How do we get each one of those? If this hydride comes in and adds to the front face of the molecule, the oxygen will be in the back, and this new hydrogen will be in front. Then as we reprotonate it, we get the S2-butanol. If the hydride comes in from the back side of the molecule, that pushes the oxygen to the front. That when we reprotonate it, we get the R2-butanol. Now there are several examples of enantioselective reduction reactions with carbonyls. One set of them are the Cori-Bakshi-Shibata reactions that use oxazoborylidene borane complexes. I'm not going to go into those ones in detail, but I thought I would go through the example of how NADH works because of its great impact in biology and biochemistry. So NADH is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, and we'll actually only look at part of the molecule. The way that we'll usually draw this is with an R down here, and we'll put our amide out on this side. So if we look at this whole big piece over here, is going to be what we refer to as our R group. And what are interesting, of course, are the hydrogens that are on here. These hydrogens. Because if we lose one of those hydrogens, we can reform aromaticity. So what happens is when NADH reacts with some kind of a carbonyl in the body, this pair of electrons comes over, this pair of electrons goes up, and it pushes off a hydride, which now it's a hydride donor. The difference between this hydride donor and the ones we've been studying is that this hydride donor has specific stereochemistry. If you look at the stereocenters up here, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 stereocenters on this sugar ring, and there are 1, 2, 3, 4 more stereocenters over here. So there are 8 stereocenters in this molecule. So now it can attack from a specific side. So typically in the body, this reaction will be enzyme catalyzed, and the enzyme will be what sets the stereochemistry of the product. So now we've reformed an aromatic ring here, but now there are 4 bonds to this nitrogen. So this is now an NAD plus. So NADH is our reducing agent that adds a hydride to our carbonyl, reduces it to a specific enantioselective alcohol, yielding NAD plus, which is the oxidized version of NADH. And so now NAD plus is a biological oxidizing agent, so that can oxidize things by itself being reduced. So here's an example of how it will work in the body. So in a biological example of this, pyruvic acid, which is the final product of glycolysis, reacts with NADH and lactate dehydrogenase, which is an enzyme, to catalyze the reaction. So now your NADH is your hydrogen donor, and that's what's causing this reduction. And it reduces the carbonyl next to the carboxylic acid and gives only S-lactic acid. It's 100% selective. So in the process of this, it also then reforms NAD+, which can now enter back into the glycolysis cycle.